गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल, वेलकम बैक टू डीसीईबी सूर्यापेट खम्मम बायोसाइंस ऑनलाइन क्लास. माई सेल्फ कौसर अंजुम, वर्किंग एज टीजीटी साइंस इन टीएस मॉडल स्कूल, इमामपेट विलेज, सूर्यापेट मंडल एंड डिस्ट्रिक्ट. चिल्ड्रन, टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू एक्सप्लेन यू अबाउट ब्लड, इट्स कॉम्पोजिशन एंड एबीओ टाइपिंग. So in this topic, we are going to learn what is blood, what composition it has, and what are the functions of blood cells, and also how many types of blood groups are there, and how can we confirm a person's blood group. So after my class, what the learning outcomes we are going to know. So here, let's have a glance on this slide. After my class, you can able to give answers for the questions like what is blood, what is the composition of the blood, why the blood is red in color, which organism has colorless blood, and which organism has blue color blood and why. And also you can explain about the varieties of blood cells and their functions in detail. Finally, you will be able to perform a lab activity by which you can identify a person's blood group. So let's begin this session with the concept that is of blood composition. So here, children, what is blood? Blood is a fluid connective tissue. Why it is called as fluid connective tissue? See here, children, fluid is a term which is used to describe liquid or gas. So blood is a liquid, so it can be called as a fluid. So blood is a fluid connective tissue. Why it is a connective tissue? Because it always circulates in our body and connects all the organs. So it is a connective tissue. Now, it can be called blood as a tissue, yes, because it has its own cells, right? Now, what is the color of blood? Blood is red in color, isn't it? Due to the presence of pigment called hemoglobin. So, hemoglobin is a pigment. So, here you have to remember the term pigment means a substance which gives color. So in previous classes, in your early classes, you have learned that pigment, green plants are green, green in color because of the presence of pigment called as chlorophyll. And we human beings we have a skin color because of the presence of a pigment called as melanin. Okay, so if the melanin content is more, then the complexion is dark. And if the melanin content is less, then we have fair complexion. So here blood is red in color because of the pigment called as hemoglobin. So what is the meaning of hemoglobin here? Heme in the sense iron, and globin is a protein. So heme is the iron and globin is the protein. Now here a question arises that do all organisms have red color blood? Means no. All organisms do not have red color blood. We have red color blood because of hemoglobin, and a few other organisms may have different other pigments, and some organisms may not have any pigment. Here I have taken the example of cockroach. So this cockroach does not have any color in its blood. So if you kill a cockroach, you can see some white substance is coming out of its body. So it has white colored blood, or we can say it has colorless blood. So why the cockroach has colorless blood means there is no pigment in its body. When there is no pigment, there will be no color. And coming to the snail here, snail has blue color blood. So why the snail has blue color blood means it has another pigment, which is not like hemoglobin, that is called as hemocyanin. Because of the presence of hemocyanin, it is the snail has blue color blood. I hope you have understood why blood is of various colors and why do we have red color blood. Now we will see the composition of blood. In its composition, this we will see what the blood is composed of. So here blood contains both liquid part and solid part. Okay, children. So blood contain liquid part and solid part. Liquid part is called as plasma and solid part are the blood cells. So here this plasma is composed of what? Plasma contains more amount of water. Along with that, some substances are also present. What those substances are? Glucose, amino acids, proteins, vitamins, hormones, excretory products, blood clotting factors, and anti-clotting factors. Here the example I have taken as heparin, which prevents the clotting of blood. Next, coming to the solid part of the blood, here the blood cells, there are three types of blood cells are found in our blood. The first are red blood cells, second, white blood cells, third, blood platelets. These can also be called as, red blood cells can also be called as erythrocytes, and white blood cells can also be called as leukocytes. Blood platelets can also be called as thrombocytes. So here the meaning of erythro means red, cyte means cell, red cell. The meaning of leuko is white, cyte means cell, white cell. So there are three types of blood cells we can see in the blood. The first is red blood cells, second the white blood cells, and third blood platelets. Next, we cannot find any differences in the structure of RBCs. All the RBCs are similar. Okay, and coming to the blood platelets also, they all are similar. But if you take here white blood cells are all cells are not similar. They are of various types depending upon the presence of granules and depending upon the absence of granules. So here, white blood cells are categorized into two types. The first is, the first are granulocytes and second are agranulocytes. Granules means solid particles seen in the cells. Granules means solid particles. So here I have given a picture here. That is, this is a cell. In this, there are some solid particles are there. These are nothing but granules. And this is a cell. So it is called as granulocyte. And if you see here, agranulocytes, here this cell does not have any granules. So it is a granulocyte, A in the sense absence, absence of granules in the cells. Is it okay, children? Right. Now, granulocytes are of three types. One is acidophils, second basophils, and third neutrophils. And coming to the agranulocytes, these are of two types. The first is lymphocytes and second monocytes. So once again, I'll recapitulate the blood composition, children. Blood is a fluid connective tissue. It comprises of both liquid and solid part. Liquid part is called as plasma and solid part are blood cells. So plasma is again composed of water and some of the substances like glucose, amino acids, proteins, vitamins, etc. And coming to the blood cells, children, there are three types of blood cells. First, RBCs, second, WBCs, and third, blood platelets. Okay, RBCs and blood platelets are all similar in their shape, structure, function, and everything. Whereas coming to the WBCs, WBCs are categorized into two main cells. The first, granulocytes, and second, agranulocytes. Okay, granulocytes are further contains three types of cells, acidophils, basophils, and neutrophils. And coming to agranulocytes parts, there are two types, lymphocytes and monocytes. I hope you can understand. This is the concept, ma'am, for your easy remembrance and so that you can remember it easily and have a glance whenever you need it. Now we will move further. Now I'll explain you what are the functions of blood cells. So here, see here, children. There is one more concept map for easy remembering. So here the blood cells and their functions. In previous slide, I explained you there are three types of blood cells: red blood cells, white blood cells, and blood platelets. So here I'll explain you what are the functions of red blood cells. So red blood cells contain hemoglobin. Okay, the role of hemoglobin is to bind oxygen and to take that oxygen to all our body, and also it can bind carbon dioxide. So red blood cells, the major function is it transports gases like oxygen and carbon dioxide. And next, coming to the white blood cells. White blood cells are the police for our body. What the police do? Police will protect us from thieves or from any other enemies when we feel insecure. In the same way, white blood cells are also guarding our body. How they will guard our body? In the sense, these cells will attack and destroy the foreign objects, foreign bodies like germs. When bacteria enter into our body, bacteria does not belong to our body, so it is a foreign particle to our body. Then WBCs will become active, recognize that bacteria, and will fight with that bacteria, and finally will destroy that bacteria. What happens by the destroying of the bacteria means we will be safe from getting off any diseases or any damage to our body. So white blood cells are very, very important. These are protecting our body. These are nothing but immune system of our body. Okay, next, coming to the blood platelets. So blood platelets, these are also most important cells, children. When we are injured, what happens? Definitely the blood will come out. And if you don't stop also, after a few minutes, like 1 to 3 minutes, what happens? The blood will automatically stop. It will not come out. What happens there? How it can stop automatically means the wounded area, all the platelets come and will form a mesh-like mesh, and it does not allow the blood to go out, because of which the blood will get clotted. Okay, so blood platelets are very, very important. These makes blood to clot when an injury occurs. Okay, I hope you have understood what are the functions of blood cells. Red blood cells helps in the transport of gases. White blood cells protect our body from germs. And third, blood platelets, it makes the blood to stop after an injury. Here I have given two lines, those are neutrophils are called as microscopic policemen. So microscopic, why the neutrophils are microscopic? Because these are observed under microscope. And why these are called as policemen means these protect our body from bacteria. So these are called as policemen for our body. Next, coming to the monocytes, which are type of WBCs. These two are the types of WBCs. Next, monocytes are called as scavengers. So what does the term scavenger mean? Scavenger is nothing but who cleans the dirt or who cleans the unwanted substances and make the area and keeps the area clean. So here, monocytes, what it will do? It will remove all the dead bacteria, dead RBCs, dead cells, and it keeps our body clean. So these are termed as scavengers of our body. Okay, children, I hope you have understood. Now we will go to the next concept, that is where the blood cells originate. Originate in the sense where the blood cells are born, where the blood cells get originated. What is the lifespan? Lifespan means what? How many days it will live? What is the lifespan of the blood cells? And where the blood cells get destroyed? I mean, after completion of the lifespan of blood cells, they should get destroyed, isn't it? So where they will get destroyed? Where the blood cells are born, how many days they live, and where they will get destroyed? We will learn in the further slide. So here, children, the blood cells. Here the blood cells get originated in bone marrow. There are three types of blood cells, children: RBCs, WBCs, and blood platelets. All these three types of blood cells are born in bone marrow. And what is the lifespan here? RBCs live for 120 days. Okay. WBCs live for 13 to 20 days. Okay, children, once we will recall the previous slide, the information present in the previous slide. WBCs are of various types, isn't it? So few WBCs live only for 24 hours. Few WBCs survives for few weeks. Few WBCs survives for few days. So here for in an average, I have taken it as 13 to 20 days. And coming to the platelets. Platelets live for 10 days. Okay, the platelets live for only for a short time, that is 10 days. RBCs live for 120 days. WBCs live for 13 to 20 days. And blood platelets live for 10 days. And coming to the place of destruction. When RBCs completes the lifespan of 120 days, where do they destroy? Where do they get destroyed? Means they are destroyed in the organ called spleen. Spleen is present near the stomach, children. Okay. So RBCs are destroyed in the area in an organ called as spleen. And coming to the white blood cells, most of the white blood cells die during the fight with germs. And the few WBCs will die in bone marrow. And coming to the blood platelets. Blood platelets, after 10 days, they will be destroyed within liver as well as in spleen. Okay, children. RBCs are destroyed in spleen. WBCs, mostly they die during the fight with germs. And some of the WBCs will die in the bone marrow. And whereas blood platelets can be destroyed in two organs. One is the liver and second is the spleen. I hope you have understood where the blood cells are originated, what is the lifespan of various blood cells, and where the blood cells get destroyed. Next, here one interesting thing is there, that regarding the RBCs, generally red blood cells are spherical in shape. Are these round or not? Yes, these are round and these are biconcave. Okay, so the interesting fact about the red blood cells are, all the mammalian cells, mammals, what are mammals? You have learned in your early classes, okay, isn't it? So in all the mammalian cells, when the RBCs are born, they contain the nucleus. In your 8th standard, you have learned that every cell comprises of nucleus, isn't it? So here RBC is also a cell. So it should have a nucleus. Okay, so it will, here what is the interesting fact about the RBC is, when the RBCs are immature, when they are born, they contain RBC, they contain the nucleus. But as the RBCs grow older and when they become matured, the nucleus which is present in the cell get vanished, will get disappeared. So here, when there is a cell and in the cell, in the center, there will be the nucleus. And when the nucleus get vanished, there will be empty space, isn't it? The cytoplasm will be there and some of the organelles will be there. So why the nucleus get disappeared, in the sense to accommodate more amount of hemoglobin. Accommodate in the sense to give place for the more amount of hemoglobin. So what is the function of RBCs here means to bind oxygen and to take it to various parts of our body. So who will take oxygen means hemoglobin. When there is less hemoglobin in the RBC, less amount of oxygen will be bound, isn't it? When the amount of hemoglobin increases in the RBC, more amount of oxygen will be bound and we can be carried to all over the body. So to bring out its function effectively, the nucleus will get vanished and it will give more space for the accommodation of more and more hemoglobin. And when the nucleus is vanished, what happens to the shape of the nucleus means it becomes biconcave. Okay, children. So here, when the nucleus is removed from the RBC, then the RBC becomes biconcave in the shape. That means when the nucleus is born and when it is immatured, then it is fluffy and it is round. But as the nucleus is removed, it gets compressed in the center and it becomes biconcave in shape. Okay, children, you have to remember this. Next, we will enter into the second topic, that is ABO typing. In this topic, we will learn for who first classified our blood groups and how many types of blood groups are there, and how can we identify a person's blood group by performing a lab activity. Okay, so let's start this. So who first classified our blood groups means it is Karl Landsteiner who classified human blood groups into four types. Okay, those blood groups are A, B, AB and O. There are four types of blood groups seen in the human beings. Those four types were classified by Karl Landsteiner. Now, what is called ABO typing? Okay, children, so see here. When we take somebody's blood to test what type of blood group he has, then that testing of blood is called as ABO typing. So when you take somebody's blood to test the group, what he has, what the blood group he has, such type of testing of blood to identify the blood group is called as ABO typing. So here, here you can see four types of blood groups. This AB blood group is called as universal receptor. Receptor, receive means who takes. Universal means this person who has AB blood group can take blood from A blood group, the person who has A blood group, the person who has B blood group, the person with AB blood group, and the person with O blood group. He can take blood from all these type of blood groups. So AB is called as universal receptor. And coming to the O blood group, it is universal donor. Donate means to give, donor, the person who gives. O is called as universal donor. That means this O blood group, the person with the blood group O, can give his blood to A, B, AB and O. So he is called as universal donor. And mostly in your regular life, you may come across a saying that A positive blood group, A negative blood group, B positive, B negative, O positive, like that, isn't it? So how this positive and negative type of blood group depends on what it depends means it depends upon Rh factor, that means rhesus factor. So what is this Rh factor, children? We have RBCs. On that RBCs, there will be a protein which is called as Rh factor. On the RBC, there is a protein called as Rh factor. So if this Rh factor is present, then that person has positive blood group. If the Rh factor is absent, then that person blood group is negative. On the RBC, if the Rh factor is present, then he is of positive blood group. If the Rh factor is absent, then he is of negative blood group. Now, how we can determine whether the person is of A type of blood group or B type, we will learn in the further slide, children. I hope you have understood up to here. So we will move further. Now I'll explain you with a simple mind map, the transfusion of blood. What is the meaning of transfusion? So children, here in movies or in our daily lives, we can see when a person meets with an accident, he needs blood. He needs blood. So he will get blood from some other person. So transferring of blood from one person to another person is called as transfusion. Transferring of blood from one person to another person is called as transfusion. Okay, so here transfusion, in this who can transfuse the blood to whom? O blood group is universal donor. That means he can transfuse the blood to A, AB and B. Okay, so it is a universal donor. It can donate to all. So next, coming to the AB, it is a universal receptor. He can receive the blood from all. So you can see the arrow marks, children. He can get the blood from A. He can get the blood from O. He can also take the blood from the B. So AB is called as universal receptor. And coming to the blood group A. Okay, he can give blood to AB. And AB blood group can be given to another person who has A blood group. So here, next, coming to the B blood group, B can give to the person with another with the person with the same blood group, and also can be given to the AB. So this is a simple flowchart for remembering who can donate the blood to whom and who can receive the blood from whom. Okay, so we'll move further, and now we will see the lab activity to identify the blood group. So to perform any lab activity, the foremost thing we need are the required material, that is the apparatus. So here, what are the materials we need means we need a blood group identification kit. Kit in the sense it will be a box in which there will be some materials. So what this kit contain means it contains three chemical bottles. Now one is anti-serum A, second is anti-serum B, and third anti-serum D. These three bottles are present in that kit. Along with that, there will be one porcelain plate. One plate will be there, white color plate will be there for adding of blood and chemicals and mixing of those things. So with that kit, what more we require means we require wax pencil. We need a disposable needle. Okay, disposable means after use, which we can throw. So which we can dispose. So a disposable needle, we need some cotton, and we need 70% of the alcohol and a toothpick. So what we will do with these materials, we will see now. So what is the procedure for the identification of blood groups? What procedure we have to follow, we will see now. So first, what you have to do, see here children, here this is a porcelain plate. First you have to take a porcelain plate and you have to clean it and you have to dry it. Okay children, then take a wax pencil and draw two margins. Okay, take a wax pencil and draw two margins. When you draw two margins on this porcelain plate, it will be divided into three compartments. Okay children, first you have to take one porcelain plate, then you have to draw two lines so that this porcelain plate can be divided into three compartments. Now what you have to do next, you have to draw three circles, one in each compartment. Okay, so you have to draw three circles, one in each compartment. So first you have to take a porcelain plate, then you have to clean it and dry it. Then you have to take a wax pencil, draw two margins so that this complete porcelain plate can be divided into three compartments. Next, you have to draw three circles, one in each compartment. Then what you have to do, now you have to take your ring finger. This is a third finger, ring finger, and you have to press it. So before pressing, you have to take a piece of cotton and you have to dip it in the alcohol. 70% alcohol we have taken. So you have to dip that in that alcohol and you have to clean the tip of the finger. So to if any germs are present, that can be cleaned. So choose a finger and wipe the tip of the finger with a cotton ball dipped in alcohol. After cleaning, what you have to do, you have to take a needle and you have to prick your finger. You have to prick your finger quickly. You should not do it slowly, children, and you should not do multiple pricks. Okay, so at once quickly you have to prick it and you have to remove the needle and you have to dispose the needle. Okay, so and then press your finger gently so that the blood can ooze out. Here you can see first I hold this finger with the help of other fingers, and after pricking this finger with a needle, you have to press the finger gently so that the drop of blood can ooze out. Then what you have to do, you have to place one drop of blood in these three circles of this porcelain plate. So after pricking the finger, put a drop of blood, one drop of blood in all these three circles. Okay, then you have to add anti-serum A in first circle, anti-serum B in the second circle, and anti-serum D in the third circle. These anti-sera, where you have seen in your early slide, these chemicals you have got in that blood identification kit, isn't it? So you have to add those three chemicals separately in these three separate rings. Now you have to mix this antiserum and the blood drop with the help of a toothpick. Okay, take a toothpick and mix it properly. So after mixing this, use another fresh toothpick for mixing of antiserum B with this drop of blood. And again, discard that toothpick and take one more toothpick and mix this antiserum D and this blood drop. After mixing it properly, now you have to observe what changes occur in the drop of the blood and the chemical in these three rings. So now we'll move forward. See here, children, you have to observe carefully. This is the most important thing which you have to observe. See here. This complete line represents positive blood groups, and this complete row represents the negative blood group. So here I have taken three drops of bloods, and I have added antiserum A in the first drop, second antiserum B, and third antiserum D. So after mixing it properly, we have to leave it for a few seconds, and then you have to observe. So you can find here the blood got split, isn't it? When you see the milk, when the milk gets spoiled, then the solid part comes closer, leaving the water behind. You have observed the milk at your home, I think. So in the same way, blood contain RBCs and plasma. So all the RBCs come together, leaving the plasma. So here, RBCs have come closer, forming a clotting like structure, clots, forming the clumps, and leaving the liquid part, that is the plasma. This is called as agglutination. So this reaction is called as agglutination. Agglutination means forming clumps, okay. So forming clumps in the sense what, all the solids coming closer, leaving the liquid behind is called as a clump, coming various objects closer, solid objects closer is called as a clumping. So here clumping can be seen. This is called as agglutination. When you, if you observe this type of picture, that the agglutination has performed in the agglutination has formed in the A antiserum A and the blood drop, and agglutination has formed in the antiserum D and the blood drop, but there is no agglutination in the B, then that blood group is determined as A positive. Okay. And if you see agglutination in B and D, but not in A, then the blood group is determined as B positive. And if the agglutination is seen in A, B, as well as D, then the blood group is determined as AB positive. So, and if the, there is no agglutination in A and B, but there is agglutination in the D, then the blood group is determined as O positive. So here, children, you can see here, this D antiserum determines whether the blood is positive or not. If the agglutination occurs in this D antiserum and the blood drop, then it is the positive type of blood. Okay, this is all, these all are the positive types of blood. And here, if the agglutination has occurred in A, it is A positive. Here, agglutination has occurred in B, B positive. This is A, B positive, O positive. Okay, now what happened? How can we see, how can we confirm it is a negative type of blood? See here again, children, it is A, B and D. So here agglutination is seen only in the A antiserum, but not in the B and D. Here you can see, children, in the D antiserum, there is no agglutination. When there is no agglutination here, it is negative type of blood group, and agglutination is seen in the A, only A. So it is A negative. And here agglutination is seen only in the B, but not in the D. So it is a B negative. And coming to the AB negative, agglutination is seen in the A as well as in the B. A, B, but not in the D. So it is negative. AB negative. And coming to O negative, agglutination is not seen in any of the drops, either this A, B, and D. In any of the blood drops, we cannot see agglutination. So it is O negative. I hope you have understood how we can observe the changes in the blood drops and how we can confirm the blood group of a person. Okay, children. Now, it is the time for evaluation. Okay, children, after completion of the class, we have to test ourselves whether we have reached our learning outcomes or not. So to test ourselves, we need the tools called as questions. Here I have prepared a few questions for you. So here it is the first question, that is, what is blood? What is the composition of blood? So what is blood, children? Blood is a fluid connective tissue, isn't it? What is the composition of blood? Blood has both solid part as well as liquid parts. Solid part is called are the blood cells, liquid part are the plasma. So you have to write in detail about the composition. Next is the question is, how many types of blood cells are there? Write a brief note on the blood cells. How many types of blood cells are there, children? There are three types: RBCs, WBCs, and blood platelets. So write a note in the sense what you have to write here. You have to write their functions, what they do, and where they get originated. That means where they are born. What is the lifespan of those blood cells, and where they are destroyed. Okay. So you have to write in detail about all the blood cells. Next, coming to the third question. How many types of blood groups are there? Name them. How many types of blood groups are there, children? There are four types. The first is A, second B, third AB, and fourth O. There are four types of blood groups are there. So who invented, who classified these four types of blood groups in the sense? Karl Landsteiner. Okay, children. Next, write about the materials required and procedure to be followed to know the blood group of a person. So here, again, we have to recapitulate our knowledge that what are the materials required for ABO typing in the sense. Again, we have to write blood identification kit. A needle is needed. Next, a disposable needle is needed. 70% of alcohol, some cotton is needed, isn't it? And a porcelain plate, which is a part of the blood identification kit. And what is the procedure means? First, you have to take the porcelain kit, a porcelain plate, and you have to clean that, let it dry, and then take a wax pencil, draw two margins so that it can divide into three compartments. Then select your finger ring, okay, and clean the tip of the finger ring with the cotton, which is dipped in the alcohol. And after cleaning, press this ring with the help of other finger, with the help of other fingers, and take a disposable needle and just prick it. Then you will get the blood, drop of blood. You have to put that drop of blood on that porcelain plate and add three drops of blood. You have to put. Then add antiserum A, antiserum B, and antiserum D in the three respective blood drops. Then mix those blood drops with the help of a toothpick. Then you have to observe for the reaction. That means in which the agglutination is formed and where it is not formed. Depending upon the agglutination, we can determine the type of blood group, children. Okay, next, coming to the last question. What precautions to be taken while collecting the blood for ABO typing? What precautions we have to take means we have to first, we have to clean the fingertip with the alcohol, okay, to stop the infection. And second is we have to use only the disposable needle, okay. And one more thing what we can do means we have to use a fresh toothpick for mixing of three different drops with the three different antisera. Okay, children. So I hope you have understood today's topic. After completion or after watching my class, what you have to do, you have to once go through the content which is present in your textbook and try to answer the remaining questions which are present, which are given at the back of it after the completion of your lesson. Okay, Thank you, children, for watching my class. I'll meet you soon with another topic. Thank you.